Cooperative. All right, terrific. It's always a great day around church when you get to share baptisms. It's like a birthday party at church, all right? Actually, it's even better than that. It's like a baby being born, all right, at church. And so we get to share with significant moments in people's lives. And so thank you for coming out and joining us today. If this is your first time at New Hope, we're honored to have you here. There are some guest cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We promise not to irritate you at your door or mess with you on the phone, but through the mail we'll send you information that tells you what goes on around New Hope Community Church. So thanks for being here. Let me highlight a few announcements. This is a weird day. First off, we have baptism, so that's different. That's exciting, all right? Number two, I have to bail out in the third service early. So I'm going to preach first in the third service. We're going to baptize last, and we got a couple of other members of our staff doing baptisms, and because I got to get to the airport by 1:05. And sometimes I haven't finished preaching, you know, by 1:05. So, yeah, I'll only be gone a couple of days. Going to get our family back home, all right? Baby Bo, which is really the only one that counts, he'll be back today, all right? He'll be back. They arrive, Katie and Bo and her girlfriend who helped her drive, they're arriving probably around 4 o'clock this afternoon back in town. Chad's in a U-Haul truck in Little Rock this morning. He'll end up at Oklahoma City this afternoon, and I'll fly in there. I was supposed to be with him from Knoxville all the way to here because he was going to work tomorrow. That got changed at the last minute, so he got to leave early. The bad news is Saturday morning when he went out to get in it, somebody else had tried to take all of their belongings. They broke into the cab, tried to get the ignition started, messed up the ignition, but the good news is they got nothing, all right? So Chad had to wait 6 hours to get the ignition repaired and then on the road. He's sick while he's driving, so you just might be praying for him. He sounded really bad this morning. So anyway, so it's kind of a crazy day, but that's all right. We had so much fun at 8 o'clock service. They got out 15 minutes early. Yeah. I didn't say you were getting out 15 minutes early, Bob. I said they got out 15 minutes early today. They don't get an extra sermon just because you all get cut short, you know, so they got the same sermon y'all are going to get, all right? But anyway, good to have you here. Let me highlight a few things, and then we'll get engaged in our baptisms. There's an insert in your bulletin about Pop's Marketplace. This is named after Pop, all right, my dad, because it's the small group that Dad's a part of that are doing. This is a small group project that they want to do that they think will be helpful for New Hope. Let me first of all tell you what it's not before I tell you what it is, okay? This is not really a place for you to advertise your business, okay? What this really is if you have a need. This is more what this is about. So let's say you have a business. Let me use John Realhorn, for example. John Realhorn has Belmont Nursery. John Realhorn needed some employees not long ago, and so we put just a little blurb, all right, out, and he got some candidates that were good. That was a good thing. So we weren't trying to get you to go to Belmont Nursery to buy plants, so that's a good thing to do, but what it is, hey, I have a need. I need some employees. Let's say you have a need at your house. You need somebody to come do some gardening work, all right? You can't do it yourself. And you can put the ad in there. Hey, I need to buy a washer and dryer, and I can't afford a new one. Somebody got to be those kind of things. Does that make sense? Okay, so Pop's Marketplace, you're going to try to update it every couple of weeks, all right? So it'll be in for a couple of weeks, and we'll try to update it. So this is the way we're going to start. You kind of put your thing on here, put it in the offering, drop it off in the office, okay? Email something equivalent to this, and we'll get it to the small group. And it'll be out at the welcome cart. Okay, you can drop this off at the welcome cart today, all right? And there's a bin in the welcome cart. I didn't get my instructions. You can drop this in the bin. If you drop it in the offering, we'll get it out there as well. And then the small group will do it, and they'll print it. We'll try to see if we can get it online as well. But we think it'll just be advantageous, okay? If you've got needs and wants, this is a way to get them taken care of. All right? tonight. Biggest thing of the day besides baptism this morning, pasta feed tonight. You can buy your tickets, $5 for dinner tonight. And by the way, if you signed up to bring pasta, don't forget to bring your pasta. You won't have anything to eat that you buy your ticket for, all right? So $5 a person, $20 for a family. If you got six in your family, such a deal, all right? And you can't adopt anybody today, okay, to make your family bigger. Raffle tickets are available today, so if you can't come back tonight, that doesn't mean you can't still help with a fundraiser. This is to help our fifth and sixth grade kids go to camp. And so you can go out and you can buy, is it what, $5 for your height, $10 for your, $20 for your height, okay? And if you want to use Fawn, she only charges $5, all right? She only charges $5 to use her. But then you go by, you put your name on your ticket and or your phone number and drop it by the things that you would like to most inherit, all right? And so you can do that this morning. All the things are out there that will be there tonight, and the raffle will take place tonight. Guys, coming up for you, there's a special date in June. I want you to notice it is our June 11th breakfast, and our very own Ray Steele, former editor of the Fresno Bee, is going to be speaking that day. That will be great fun, and don't look, but he's sitting to my left about four rows from the back on the end of the pew, all right? But anyway, we're excited to have Ray come and share with our guys that day. Widow's Lunch Bunch is taking place today at Applebee's at 12:30. So those are the updates that we wanted to highlight for you. You see the names of all the folks that we're baptizing that are in the bulletin between the two services today. Let me highlight just a couple of extra prayer requests. Carolyn Gilmore is now under hospice assistance in her home. So please be praying for Carolyn. For those of you who know her, she'd love a visit. Saw her this past week. She's doing. Her spirits are just absolutely terrific. Jan Patton. Had a great visit with Jan this week. She will be going home Wednesday from the hospital, all right? So that's great news. For those of you who don't know, Jan Patton is the person who was stabbed by a person she rented a room to, all right? She's from our church. She was stabbed 7 times. She was in ICU and unconscious for almost 3 full weeks, all right? She has no memory of the stabbing nor the 3 weeks in ICU. None, absolutely, all right? She's doing great. She's in the rehab floor, 6th floor. Visits are great there, room 669. She's feeling so well that she thought she should show me her scar. Okay? It looked really good from what I could tell, all right? But anyway, yeah, she's just doing terrific. So that was just really, really exciting to see. And then pray for the Dunlaps. They'll be heading home this week. Tomorrow is an important day and a challenging day for them. This is when they go before the judge for guardianship of her mom. And this is not a, mom is 90. Mom is in good physical health, but very rapid declining mental health. And it is a challenge. And the son who lives back there is the one dealing with this 24/7. So they went back to be of assistance, and hopefully things get taken care of tomorrow. And they hope to bring mom home with them for a few weeks. So be praying for them for the adventure of this week. So Polly Good is continuing to recuperate from a long, difficult series of chemotherapy. They've put the rest of those on hold until she gets some more strength back. So just a few updates that are there. Those of you who are being baptized today, would you stand, please, and turn and face your family and your friends out there, all right? What I want you to do is introduce yourself real quick, all right? Just tell them your name and where you go to school. No, we'll start with Marissa right here. You go to Fugman, all right. And where did you, next, where did you go to school?
I went to school in Columbus High School.
Oh, all right, all right.
Okay,
Pam, terrific today. Fresno High, all right, Dwight. Clovis North, all right, you're in high school now, terrific. And for those of you who might be visiting and you say, what's baptism all about? Baptism is a symbol. These four men and women who are standing in front of you have already accepted Jesus Christ in their life. You don't get baptized because you're joining a church. You don't get baptized because you finished a class. You get baptized because you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That's pure and simple. And you know, man, in New Testament times, they get saved one morning and got baptized that afternoon. All right, well, that happened pretty quick. We don't always move that fast around here. But over the last few months, or sometimes it's been a year or two, folks have invited Christ. And as we provide opportunities for baptism, they say, I'm ready to make that decision. And so when we place them under the water, that's a picture of what the Bible says. We were once dead in our trespasses and sins. Though physically alive, we were spiritually dead. And when we come up out of the water, it's a testimony to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They have now been born again. They have new life. My grandfather used to say it this way, and I didn't like it back then, but as I get older, I start to like things I didn't like when I was younger, all right? My grandfather used to say, they're coming up out of the watery grave. and that sounded so, but yet, that's the reality of what it is, all right? It's the picture that I'm no longer dead, and that when physical death does come, it doesn't have the last word, but life does. So I'm going to ask you all if you would go on out and prepare yourselves. I am going to head back there and change my clothes. And am I supposed to do offering now in this service? Okay, so I'm confused today. I'm doing things different. All right, so this time our ushers are going to come forward as we receive our morning tithes and offering, and then depending on how quickly everybody's ready, we'll determine how much worship that we're going to do right now. All right, so team, come on up as well. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for life and the life that you share with us today. I'm just thrilled and excited with the 10 men and women and young people that New Hope gets to baptism with. It's great for the rest of the church to know that there are still men and women and young people, boys and girls, who are saying yes to a relationship with Jesus Christ. This thing we call being a Christian is not old-fashioned. It's not gone out of style. We haven't gotten so smart that we don't need God anymore. And so thank you, Father, for the joy and the privilege of sharing that today. We trust you with the needs that we've already acknowledged today and the needs that also may be very personal and private to those who've gathered. You are big enough for the task for all of them, and we say thanks. We commit this day and our lives to you in the incredible name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen and amen.
Nice and slow. Get slippery.
It is slippery.
All right. Yeah. It got slippery, isn't it?
Yeah. I told him in the 8 o'clock service, Dwight is a regular at the 8 o'clock service, all right? But, I mean, he is here every Sunday. I told him in the 8 o'clock service, this was going to be a first for me. I have never, ever baptized a country western star, all right? And so word get put on Facebook, Tim Rolen, New Hope, baptized Dwight Yoakam, all right? Because it is true. It is factual. I first met Dwight in his home. His wife, Denise, was under hospice care. And I had met her one other time before. And she asked if I would come see her. And that one visit turned into about three visits, if not four, before it was all over. And had the privilege of knowing that Denise knew Jesus Christ as her Savior and Lord. And she said, Tim, if it wasn't for my health, I'd be in church. And I'm gonna make an honest confession. I figured I'd never see you again. And man, I think it was the second week after the memorial service, you were here, and we haven't got rid of you since then. And I am so excited. And Dwight has given his life to Christ. This is one of the nicest, sweetest men that you will ever meet in your life. And I got to tell you, and I think I told you this in your home, you married up when you married Denise. You did good, man. I mean, you did really, really good. But she also married up because character and kindness is important. And you showed that to her in her worst moments. I was so awed by the kindness that you gave and the patience that you showed in difficult times. So thank you. So here's the big question. You're standing in these waters for a reason. And I want them to hear from you. Have you invited Jesus Christ in your life to be your Savior and Lord?
Yes, I have.
Amen. Then it is a privilege to share in this moment. If you happen to be part of Dwight's family or friends and you're here today, stand up real quick. All right, well, I know some of them are here. Good. All right, look. All right. Small group over there, family over here, family up here. Yeah. And I know these two over here can sing. All right, I ought to make them sing while they're here, but I won't do that to them today.
Get right up close to that step, Dwight. Just like this. All right. Yeah, perfect.
Dwight, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it is my joy, it is my privilege, it is my honor to baptize you as my brother in Christ. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Cover your nose. There we go.
Amen.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Come on, Pam. It gets slippery. Woo-hoo. Yes, it does. There we go. Well, we've never lost anybody yet. This is Pam Murphy. All right. If you're part of Pam's family or friends and you're here today, would you please stand? All right, I know there are some here. All right, right over here, right over here. This is exciting. This is terrific. And that guy over there who stood up?
Mm-hmm.
He's going to rank probably in the top five all-time smartest guys I've ever had a conversation with.
He's smart, all right.
He is smart. Yes, he is. And the fact he's in church even tells me he's smarter. All right? So that's a good thing. So the big question for you, Pam, is do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
I do.
You've invited him to come live in your life.
I have.
Amen. When did that happen for you?
15?
16? Years ago or 15 years old?
15 years old.
Because that would only be about 20 years ago instead
about.
Of 15 years ago. Okay.
Just about.
All right. Get right up here. Your toe's right at the edge of that.
My
right?
toe?
No. Just at the edge of the step.
Okay.
Perfect. Do your hand just like this. Pam, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, this is a joy and a treat for me. I get to baptize you as my sister in Christ, and I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's a waterproof watch you had on.
It is.
Okay, good. Probably should have said that as she came in rather than going out, huh? Okay, brother and sis, why don't you come in together, all right? Careful in the front here. This is Marissa. Marisa. Slippery, isn't it? Yeah, this is Nicholas, all right? This is the sister, this is the brother, okay? And this is the older one, all right? This is the younger one. I've known you guys since before you were. That goes back a long time, huh?
Since we were born.
Yeah. But I saw your mother, all right, when she didn't know what to call you yet, all right? So your family has been around my family and our church for a long time. It started with Angela, all right? And then she's just kind of a pest about those kind of things, so she just stays after everybody in the family. And I am so grateful for that. You all have grown up here. You've been in Sunday school. You've been in youth group. So the question I have for both of you, not because of the family you were born into and not because of the church that you attend, but have each of you invited Jesus Christ to come live in your life, forgive you of your sins, and be your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Yes.
Terrific. Amen. God bless you. And I hope that you remember this day every day for the rest of your life, because it can govern some of the most important choices that you still had ahead of you. The two people I baptized before you, they don't have as many years of choices ahead of them. No offense. Okay. They've left the room, so they didn't hear any of that. And you don't need to tell them I said it, okay? But you still have a lot of years of choices ahead of you. And I trust that you will allow the moment you invited Christ in your life and this moment as a public statement, I hope you'll let it govern the choices you make in the future. Okay? All right. Nicholas, since it's girls first, even though you're oldest, I'm going to ask you to come stand right over here, and we're going to do your sister first. All right? Step up a little closer that way. All right, good. Take your hand just like this. Marisa, because of the profession of faith that you have made in Jesus Christ, because you've asked him to be your Savior, to forgive you of your sin, it is my joy and my delight. I baptize you now not as your pastor, but as your brother in Christ. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Nicholas, Clovis North student, but more importantly, a child of God. Because you've invited Christ into your life to be your Savior and Lord, it is my joy and my delight to baptize you as your brother in Christ. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So this is Emily, and it's a particularly exciting day for me because I get to baptize my own daughter, which is not very often you get to say that. So Emily is, how old are you, Emily? I was going to tell you, but I want her to speak.
8 years old,
okay. And you, Pastor Tim has already asked you if you've let Jesus Christ into your life, and you did that at home. And we remember that. That was probably 8 months ago. Yeah. Okay. All right. We're going to make this quick. So. All right. Because of your profession of faith, Emily, it is my great pleasure, not just as your dad, but also your brother in Christ, to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
This is always exciting. This is, for a church family, this is like giving birth, all right? We get to share with young men and women. We get to share with older men and women this incredible new relationship that they have with Jesus Christ. So for those of you who might be visiting with us for the very first time and you wonder, why do they get all excited about this? Because this is one of the most exciting moments. It lets us know that this idea of a relationship with God is not old-fashioned. It's not out of vogue. It's still very, very important. And so this is thrilling. So, Michaela, come on down, you Clovis East girl. All right.
Okay, look out there, Tim, just for a minute. That's what I look at every Sunday.
You're going to pray more for me now, aren't you?
Yeah,
all right. It's a whole lot different from up here than it is out there. Huh?
Oh, yeah.
But they're all very excited because you're here, because you've accepted Christ into your life. And so what grade are you going to be next year at Clovis East?
I'll be a senior.
You'll be a senior. You'll be wrapping it up and heading off to college. Yep. Here's my challenge to you. Remember this day when you're in college. Let this day govern many of the directions and decisions that you will make as a college student. Because college is going to challenge your faith like nothing you've ever experienced in life. And let this hold you steady. Okay? All right. Turn and face all those wonderful looking people over there. Take your hand like this. Okay? You can go ahead and do that. Michaela, because you've invited Christ in, you, just in case I get in a hurry, okay? Because, not that you're American, or not that you've attended New Hope Church, but because you've invited Jesus Christ to come live in your life, it is my privilege, my joy, my delight to baptize you as my sister in Christ. We're the same family now. And I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bless you, Michaela. Okay. We're going to try something here. We're going to get three of you down here at once, okay? I think we can do this. Come on, hold my hand and put the other hand right here. It gets slippery, okay? I'm going to ask you to stay right there on that step, okay? Actually, we're baptizing four. One of them just doesn't know it yet, okay? Is there a doctor in the house by any chance? I've heard about doing births in water before, so we might try that. Georgia, come on down.
I'm going to go down there.
In just a minute. I'll get you down there, but if we get you down there now, they can't see you, okay? So this is three generations. This is so rare to be able to get to do this. So this is really exciting. This is mom and daughter and grandson and son. And so this is a special, special moment. Adrian, I got saved when I was 5. You were even younger than I was. My folks made me wait till I was 8 to get baptized so that I would remember and never forget it. I want you to know something. I never forgot the day I was baptized. My father and both of my grandfathers were there with me on that day. And it was very, very special. And I want you to look out and you see your dad there and you're here with your mom and your grandmother. And I want you never, ever to forget this day, all right, and what it means. All right, I'm going to ask mom and grandma just to step back. And I'm going to let you turn right there on that step, all right? And you already got your nose ready, okay? That's good. Adrian, because you've invited Jesus Christ to come live in your life, forgive you of your sins, be your Savior and Lord, it is my privilege to baptize you. I baptize you as my younger brother in God's family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Woo! All right, now stand right here. Watch your mind. All right, stand right here. Sit right here. Sit right here. Okay, perfect. Perfect. Okay, we'll go in age order. We'll go from youngest to oldest, okay? It's too late to go the other way. Well, a twofer. I've never done that before. Hey, this is so cool. You have no idea how so many of us prayed for you. The first time I met you, I went home and told Shelley about you. And I said, I got to tell you about this young couple that's just started coming to church and they want to get married. And we talked about the challenges that you all were facing. And yet there was something about your tenacity. I said, when she finally gives her life to Jesus, she's going to be something amazing. And so I was so thrilled when I got the call. Tell everybody how many children you now have currently?
3.
How many were you going to have?
3.
All right. Number 4. All right.
But it's a girl.
All right. You heard it first here. All right. It's a girl. All right. We better hurry up because he's freezing. All right. Get your toes right up to the edge of the step. Great. All right. Andrea, hold your hands. All right. Andrea, because you took a long time to think about. No, that's not a negative. That's a positive. I'd rather you take time, look at all the options, think it through, and then willfully make a decision to let Christ be your Lord and Savior. It is my joy today to baptize you as part of God's family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Georgia, it's been great fun to have your family become part of our family here, and it's been exciting to watch you come along and to be able to pray with your husband as well and to know that he was prepared when that moment for him came. So thank you for sharing this joy with us. She called midweek this week and said, is it too late to get in on it? No, it wasn't too late, so we're thrilled to be able to do that. Turn and face your grandson right there, all right? Take your hand just like this. Georgia, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it's a joy to share this with your daughter and with your grandson, but I baptize you as part of God's family. That makes all of us brothers and sisters in his family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you guys. Mark Addis, who you saw baptize his daughter, is the newest member of our church staff as he's become our associate pastor. And now to wrap things up is another new member of our staff since last year, and that is our youth pastor, Chris Bishop. Chris, come on in and share with us your baptism.
Watch your step. It's a little slippery. All right. So, Cameron, why don't you tell everybody, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want Jesus in my life, and I want him to, help me through.
Nice. I'll take it. So, because, here, I'll have you go on this side. It'll be a little easier. There you go. Because Jesus came into your life. You said yes to Jesus. Pastor Tim asked you that a little bit earlier. Yeah. We get to baptize you today. So, I'm so excited to do that. So, let's get it done. Should I go ahead and turn that way right there? Remember, hand thing?
Yeah.
There we go. Put your hand on your nose. There you go. All right, so Cameron, I baptize you as your brother, not just as your pastor, not just as your friend, but as your brother in Christ. I am so excited to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Okay, turn your Bibles, if you will, to Psalm 77. Psalm 77, if you would, please. We're studying the Psalms because the Psalms, I think, is the best book of the Bible for us to practice what is necessary for us to enjoy a less, more lifestyle, less doubt, more faith, less fear, more trust, less frustration, more patience. And the key to making that happen is contemplation. And the Psalms lead us into those moments of meditation and contemplation. David wrote Psalm 77, and he starts out in a bad mood. He said, I cried out to God for help. I cried out to God to hear me. When I was in distress, I sought the Lord. It's a good thing when your life is in calamity for you to seek the Lord. But may I make a suggestion to you? It's even better to seek the Lord when you're not in trouble. And I think I can say this with 100% assurance. If you will seek the Lord when you're not in trouble, you will have to seek Him less when you are in trouble. You understand that? You'll find yourself in less trouble when you have been seeking Him in the regular days of your life, in the normal days, in the rather boring days of your life. If you are seeking Him and following His direction, then you will have less of these moments that David's talking about right now. It's not that you won't have any, but I really do believe you will have less. David said, at night I stretched out untiring hands. My soul refused to be comforted. I remembered you, O God, and I groaned. That doesn't sound real good, does it? I remembered you and I groaned. Teresa, how would you like it if Ethan said, I thought of Teresa and I groaned? That would be rather frustrating, wouldn't it? All right? Yeah, it would be. That just does not sound good at all right? And this is kind of what David does. But here's the deal. I've had moments when I've thought of God and I've groaned. When I was in the midst of rebellion and I thought of God, I groaned. When I responded to my first impulse rather than prayed and I thought of God, I groaned. When I was in a season of rebellion against God, and I thought of Him, I groaned. David then says, I mused, and my spirit grew faint. I'm not sure I can fully explain to you what musing is at the moment, but I don't think it's good. David said, I mused, and I grew faint. You kept my eyes from closing. In other words, God, you wouldn't let me go to sleep. I was too troubled to speak. I thought about the former days and the years long ago. I remembered my songs in the night, and my heart mused. Here it is again. My heart mused, and my spirit inquired. What did your spirit inquire when you mused, David? Will the Lord reject us forever? Will He never show us His favor again? Will His unfailing love vanish forever? I don't know about you, but musing doesn't look too good to me. Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has He in anger withheld His compassion? Then I thought, okay, remembering and thinking, not always the same thing. David said, then I thought, to this I will appeal for the years of the right hand of the Most High. I'll remember the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your mirror. He says, now instead of just remembering God, I'm going to remember who God is. I'm going to think about who God is. I will remember His miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all His works, and I will consider your mighty deeds. Your words, O God, are holy. What God is so great as you are, God? You're the one who performs miracles, display your power among the people. With your mighty arm, you redeem your people and the sins of Jacob and Joseph. Is this the same guy? For verses 1 through 9, he's whining. He's saying, God, did you forget me? Now all of a sudden, God, you're the greatest. It's kind of like a wife who one day says to her husband, I wouldn't marry you again if you were the last man on earth. And then he surprises her with her anniversary gift that's everything she wanted. Oh, honey, you are the best man in the world. Changed just like that. That's David with God. He's mad in the first hand, then all of a sudden he remembers he got his eyes off himself. Elijah, God's iron man of the Old Testament, became so discouraged that he sat under a juniper tree and he prayed to die. The scripture says in Mark's gospel, Jesus himself sighed deep within his spirit. Paul had so many difficult experiences in Asia that when he wrote 2 Corinthians, he said in the first chapter, I've despaired even to my life. I'm not sure if I want to live. Somebody once said, discouragement is the common cold of emotions. Eventually, it affects us all. Many of the world's and the church's greatest leaders have been given to despair. Winston Churchill confessed that he was often hounded by the black dog of despair. Charles Spurgeon, the greatest preacher, probably next to the Apostle Paul who ever lived, fought continuously bouts of depression as a result of gout. Bouts of gout. It's really not funny because it killed him at 58. When you look at a library of books that Charles Haddon Spurgeon wrote, I probably do not have enough bookshelves in my office to contain all the writings of Charles Haddon Spurgeon, and he died at 58 years of age. Many years ago, a young Midwestern lawyer suffered from such deep depression that his friends thought it best to keep all the knives and the razors out of his reach. He questioned his calling in life and the prudence over attempting to follow through on his dreams. During that time, he wrote in his journal, I am now the most miserable man alive. Whether I shall ever be better, I cannot say. I awfully forebode that I shall not. But somehow, somewhere, and actually I do know the where, because I've read his biography, out of the scriptures, Abraham Lincoln received the encouragement that he needed, and the achievements of his life thoroughly vindicate his bout with discouragement. If you are singing the blues this morning, or if the tune of the blues is very familiar in your life, it might help us to know that the psalmist understood and wrote about the blues in Psalm 77. This man bore all the marks that would today be diagnosed as depression. He was looking at life through very dark-colored lenses. He felt forgotten and forsaken by God. He couldn't sleep. He couldn't articulate his thoughts. He remembered when he was happy and had a song in his heart, but that hadn't been true in a long time. He couldn't seem to get back to where he wanted to be, no matter how hard he tried. He became so depressed that he even began to question God, verses 7 through 9. Has God rejected me? Has God forgotten me? Does God care? Does God love anymore? Those are sharp, piercing questions, but they are the question that come right out of the psalmist as he wallowed in despair. He hadn't reached that place overnight, and most of us don't get there in the twinkling of an eye. There's a progression to these emotional experiences. I have been told and I've read that despair begins with disappointment. Hi, guys. Welcome. I'm glad you made it. That's our high school crew coming in, all right? It's good for them. Despair begins with disappointment that is not handled constructively. The pattern normally looks like this. Disappointment leads to doubt. Doubt leads to depression. Depression leads to despair. Simple disappointment is the father of despair. Some of us might be like the psalmist, and we question whether God has left us without any help in our time of trouble or frustration. But David made a startling insight that saved him from his despair. In verse 10, he says, this is my infirmity. He recognized the problem was within himself. This is what Celebrate Recovery calls owning your stuff. All right? You got to stop blaming somebody else, and you got to say, hey, the reason I have sunk to where I am is because, man, look at my thinking right now. Psalm 77 has tremendous value for anyone who's ever faced the serious questions of life. Is God dependable? Are there absolutes in life? And just a brief commercial. In about 5 or 6 weeks, I'm going to take a break from this series, and I'm going to preach a particular sermon. And we're going to address, is there a place that you and I get absolute values of life from? We are facing a time in our culture where values are fluctuating very, very rapidly at a speed like I have never seen in my lifetime. And there are some issues that are coming up, and they are going to become hotbeds of topic. And as a pastor, I cannot ignore them. And I think we need to lay them out there and honestly talk about it. I'll be honest, you guys are probably not, some of you are not going to like what we're going to talk about. Remember the series I did a couple of years ago, The Things I Hate to Preach About? This one has moved right to the top of the list. I hate it more than any of the others. But we're going to address it. Why? Because I do believe there is a place for absolute value to come from. Is there meaning to life? Is there purpose to the existence that I have? Here is a man in Psalm 77 who finds his way from the despairing conclusions expressed in verse 10. I'm in a bucket load of grief at the right hand of God. To three verses later, he says, "Your ways, O God, are holy. You are awesome, God. You're phenomenal." He saw that his doubts were due to his own weaknesses, not God's negligence. Often we end up in despair because we think God is neglecting us. God does not neglect us. Often it's our own weakness. It was at this point that David determined to do something about the problem. In verses 10 and 11, four times David says, "I will, I will, I will, I will." This is significant. You and I do not have to be helpless victims to our emotions. We do not have to be hijacked by bad attitudes and poor perspectives. We can take actions. Our thoughts ought to govern our moods rather than let our moods govern our behavior. Not all, but some depression arises from really faulty thinking, and we have within us the power to change those thoughts, to deal with these harmful emotions. We must mentally and spiritually be aware. If we don't handle our emotions, guess what, folks? Our emotions will handle us. You ever heard somebody say, "I got so mad I just couldn't control myself"? That's emotions gone crazy. That's emotions on steroids. There's an answer for those. How are Christians supposed to deal with disappointment? In the latter part of the psalm, verses 11 through 20, the psalmist tells us what he did. And we can be victorious by doing the very same thing. I'm going to look at three of the "I wills" that David talked about here. First of all, he said, "I will concentrate on the greatness of God." The scripture says David did this by meditating on the deeds of the Lord. He thought long and hard about God's action in history, concrete, stubborn facts that cannot be forgotten or explained away, which have been witnessed by hundreds and thousands and even millions of people, and the results of which permanently altered the course of history. In the last part of this psalm, David's attention goes back to the Exodus, when the nation of Israel was delivered from Egyptian captivity and they were on their way to the promised land. Was David present then? No, he wasn't even born yet. But he knows the history. Why? Because millions of his countrymen were there. It has been told from generation to generation. And David says, "How can I not remember those great deeds that you did?" You see, what David did is he remembered God's word. Study God's word when you are discouraged, when you are disappointed, and it will keep you from despair. I recently read in a magazine article that 93% of depressed Christians admit to spending less than 1 hour a week in Bible study. That's less than 10 minutes a day. And I would suggest to you, if it said less than an hour, it's probably less than 15 minutes. How many of you spend less than 10 minutes a day eating? You're going to do it, and you're hoping, "I only take 10 minutes so you can hurry up and go eat," all right? But here's the deal. We need to spend time being nourished by God's word. There will always be circumstances that disappoint us, and they can bring us to a point of despair, but they are much less likely to if we stay in God's word and we remember how great God is. There's a song we sing that comes out of Psalm 77, "How great is our God." Sing with me, "How great is our God." Concentrating on God's past in crisis will convince us that He will do it again. The second "I will" of David in this is, "I will consistently give thanks for God's greatness." When the psalmist focused on what God had done in the past, he broke out into song, praising Him for how wonderful He was. And notice how quickly it happened. We must not find our joy in our successes, but we must find our joy in God Himself. If we find our joy in our accomplishments, then when we fail or when our success does not reach the level that we think we should, we find ourselves cast down, moving headlong into discouragement and despair. Our joy cannot come from things or accomplishments, but comes from a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. It is what Paul meant in the book of Philippians, chapter 4, from a prison cell, when Paul said, I have learned, this didn't come easy, I have learned to be content in the situations I find myself. I've had a whole lot of stuff in my life, and I have had nothing in my life. I've been strong and healthy, and I've been beaten down and abused. But guess what? My contentment was not based on my condition. It was based on my intimacy with Jesus. And last of all, David said, I will consider God's previous work. And he looks at the Exodus story. You see, all of the events in the Exodus story are redemptive. What was God doing in Egypt in order to get his people set free? You remember what God did? He sent 10 what? Plagues. Now, that's the term used from the Egyptian side. The Egyptians called them plagues. I think the Israelites called them miracles. Because those things that happened were for their redemption, their deliverance, to set them free. A miracle is when there is no other explanation but God. Shelly particularly experienced that miracle in the story I shared last week. All right, as Shelly met her friend Jennifer on the beach. That moment, that time, that situation, all that, an accident, a coincidence, really? No other explanation but God. It's miraculous. And God, throughout the Old Testament, New Testament, always had the same quality about the miracles that he did, and it was for the purpose of redeeming someone, some group of people, some situation. What does it mean to redeem? It means to restore to usefulness something that has been rendered useless. Ray Stedman is one of my top 10 preachers of all time. He used to pastor a church up in Northern California called Peninsula Bible Church. And Ray Stedman served as an intern for 3 years in the city of Pasadena in two different churches. Bible college interns are usually broke. And when he showed up in Pasadena, a very expensive place to live, he was penniless. And so the first year there, what he figured out that he could do was he had a brand new electric typewriter. And he went and pawned the typewriter. And he lived off the money of the typewriter until he got his first paycheck. And then with his first paycheck, he went and paid the price to redeem his typewriter from the pawn shop. Here's the deal. While that typewriter was in the pawn shop, it was useless. Ray Stedman couldn't use it. The pawnbroker couldn't use it. It just simply sat on the shelf, and it was useless. But once Ray paid the price to redeem it back, it now was put to use for its purpose. That is exactly what God wants to do for you and me. Apart from a relationship with Jesus Christ, no matter how temporarily successful we may be in this world, we are not fulfilling the purpose for which the Creator, God Himself, created you and me and made us life. And until we experience His forgiveness in our life and invite Him to be our Savior, as those who are going to be baptized have today, we are like that typewriter in a pawn shop. We may be around, but we are not fulfilling the function for which God has called us for. Let me wrap this up. Many times, God is at work in our lives when we cannot see His footprints. Did you read that verse in the latter part of chapter 77? Just in case you missed it, let me jump there real quick. I shouldn't have closed my Bible. Your path led through the sea, your way through the mighty waters. Though your footprints were not seen, you led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Your path through the sea, your way through the waters. When there didn't look like there was a possibility, God, You made a way somehow. When we cannot see His footprints in our life, please know this, God is at work. He promises to you and me, He will not leave us, He will not forsake us. No matter what the circumstances dictate, you and I can change from despair to rejoicing when we get our thoughts in the right place. And the right place is here. Who is God? In times of despair, I think we need to break out an old Fanny J. Crosby hymn. And for those of you under 30, we would probably have to teach it to you. But listen to the words that a blind woman wrote about her love for God. She said, all the way my Savior leads me. What have I to dread beside? Can I doubt His tender mercy? Who through my life He's been my guide? Heavenly peace, most divine comfort. Here by faith in You I dwell. For I know that whatever happens to me, Jesus, You do all things well. For I know that whatever happens to me, Jesus, You do all things well. Do you know Jesus that well? He does things very well. Let's pray. Father, thank You for Your special work of redemption in history. Thank You, Father, for the work that You did in David's life when he wrote Psalm 77, so confused one moment, so clear the next, so discouraged one moment, so thrilled the next, simply by changing his attention, by rerouting his thoughts from himself to You. What a difference You make. Thank You, Father, for giving us purpose in our lives, for moving us from despair to victory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.